All right, welcome back. I hope everybody found their way to lunch somewhere. So we have four speakers this afternoon, and our first speaker is Émilie Chouzenou. Émilie Chouzenou is maître de conférence à l'Université Paris-Est Marne-la-Vallée, and she's doing research in optimization, so in both convex and non-convex optimization problem for so it's convex and non-convex methods for inverse problems.
Okay, thank you. So thank you very much for inviting me to this meeting on big data analysis. So the aim of my talk is to show how proximal methods can provide very efficient tools to solve inverse problems on a large scale. So this is a joint work with my colleague Jean-Christophe Pesquet from Université Paris-Est and our PhD student Audrey Repetti and Feriel Aboud, and also our collaborators Anicia Florescu, Jean-Luc Chenot and Louis Laborelli and Philippe Siusio. So let me first introduce the concept of inverse problems. So the goal is, so we have an object of interest, so it could be a signal, an image, a 3D volume, a video, that we want to recover from a degraded version of this object. So such problem is encountered in a wide class of application fields, such as medical imaging, biological imaging, like on this example, also satellite imaging, seismic data analysis, video enhancement, and so on. So more formally, if we describe the object as a vector, X bar, usually the observations can be modeled as Z equals to D of H X bar, where H is a matrix which will model the acquisition process. So H can be, for example, a blur operator. And D will account for the noise degradation on our data. And the aim is to recover an estimate of X bar from the observations, Z, assuming some a priori knowledge on X bar and also on the noise statistics. So given this linear model, a natural ID will be to define the estimate x hat as h minus 1 z. So of course, assuming a simple assumption that h is invertible. However, this is a very bad ID because so if you assume an additive noise model, we can see that x hat will be equals to x bar plus h minus 1 b. And it happens that in very often inverse problems are ill-posed, which means that the matrix H is ill-conditioned. And what will happen is that even if the noise term B does not have so large components, it will be the case for H minus 1 B, and we will have an effect of amplification of the noise so that the solution X hat is completely useless in the, when there is noise. So we need to find another way to solve this problem. So a more efficient strategy is to define x hat as a minimizer of a sum of two functions, f1 plus f2, where f1 is a so-called data fidelity term, and f2 is the regularization term. So let me give some examples for these two functions. So the data fidelity term will measure the fit between the measurements, Z, and the model, HX. So the expression of F1 will depend on the assumption we have on the noise statistic. So for instance, if we made a Gaussian assumption, we could take F1 as a least square criterion. But other noise models can be taken into account, for example, Poisson noise or impulse noise. So now for the regularization term, so the aim of this term is to incorporate some a priori information we have on the object X bar in order to counter the, this ill-posed effect of the inverse problem and to make the solution more robust to the noise. So for this regularization term, we can, for instance, impose that X will verify some constraints. So for example, we can have some positivity constraints, some spatial support constraints. And so more formally, it will be done by describing F2 as the sum of indicator functions of each convex set, where the indicator function is defined as below. So another very well often used sparsity prior is we assume that X is sparse, or more generally that Fx is sparse, where F is a frame decomposition operator. And to do that, we define F2 as the sum of the absolute value of XA, of Fx, which defines the so-called L1 norm of Fx. So in the context of image restoration, a good choice for F is, for example, possibly redundant wavelet transform. Indeed, we can observe that the detailed coefficient of the wavelet transform will have a very sparse representation, which means that there will be a lot of zero or small coefficients. And finally, famous regularization term in the context of image restoration is the total variation, which is defined as the sum of the norm of the discrete gradient in the image. And this total variation will favor images with sharp boundaries and flat regions. So of course we can combine several regularization terms, and at the end what we will have is that X hat is defined as a minimizer of a sum of functions Fi, which where Fi can denote data fidelity term, one or several regularization terms, and also some constraints. So once we have this variational formulation, there is a lot which remains to be done, because this optimization problem is usually very difficult. So let me explain a bit. So here we have n, which is the dimension of the vector we want to estimate. So remember that we want to recover an image, a volume. So n corresponds to, for example, in an image, to the number of pixels in an image. So n can be extremely large. It will so for an image, it can be a million, and for a volume, we can quickly reach some 100 million, etc. So this problem is very difficult because of its size, of the size of X. And it's also difficult because for the typical shows of Fi, this problem does not have a closed form solution. It means that we need to use an iterative minimization strategy to find X hat. So we will build a sequence of vectors X which will converge to the solution of this problem. So what remains to do is to derive an efficient optimization strategy which is able to deal with such massive data. So this is the outline of my talk. In the first part, I will present proximal based algorithms. I will mainly focus on forward-backward algorithm, and I will present two ways of accelerating this algorithm to make it efficient for big data treatment. And in the second part, I will present some applications of these algorithms. So starting with the minimization of a function f, a well-known optimization algorithm is the gradient algorithm, also called the steepest descent, which consists in defining xl plus 1 as xl minus gamma l gradient of f at xl. We have a convergence guarantee on this algorithm, assuming some boundness assumption on the step size. However, this algorithm is limited to the case when F is differentiable. It means that we need to be able to define this gradient. The problem is when I show the list of regularization terms, we have seen that there is this L1 norm, the total variation norm, and these functions are not differentiable. So we cannot use this kind of algorithm, and we need a new tool to deal with this non-differentiable function. So this tool would be the subgradient. So it is defined as follows. So a subgradient is an element of this set called the subdifferential. So I will explain more graphically this formula. So in on the left, we have a scalar function. There is a quadratic part, linear part on the right, and in zero we can see that we cannot define a derivative. The function is non-smooth. And on the right, I plot possible values for the subgradients. So we can see that on the left part, the function is smooth, so the subgradient is defined as a standard gradient, so using the tangent of the function. And in zero, we will have several possible values for t. So we will have all these values, and then we reach the smooth part, so the gradient is defined in a standard way. So of course, if the function is differentiable, the subdifferential state only contains the gradient, the standard gradient. And so we can compute this subdifferential set for all non-smooth functions. So for example, I show here the expression for the absolute value which was involved in the L1 norm. So now we have a good tool to deal with non-differentiable functions. So the idea is to use the same scheme as the gradient algorithm, but to replace the gradient by this TL, which is the subgradient of the function at XL. However, there is a very bad news, which is here. We need this assumption to make this subgradient algorithm converge. And what does it mean? It means that we need that gamma L tends to zero as L goes to infinity. And this is not good, because when we will implement this algorithm, so we'll have gamma L, which diminishes at each iteration, and at some point it will become below the matching precision, so that the algorithm will stop even if the convergence is not reached. So we would like to have another algorithm without this assumption on the step size. And the idea is the following. So it seems to be a very strange idea. So we have replaced here TL by T prime L, where T prime L is defined as an element of the subdifferential, but now at x L plus 1. So this is, it seems completely crazy, because x L plus 1 does not already exist. We can also write it under this form. So the question is that, are we able to find such an x L plus 1? And what are the properties of this very strange algorithm? And we have some good news, because if we define XL plus 1 like this, first, this XL plus 1 exists. It is unique. So when we have existence and unicity, we'd like to introduce a definition and a new notation, and the notation will be the prox. So XL plus 1 will be now denoted as the prox of gamma LF at XL. So this is exactly the same algorithm, we just introduce a new notation. And now, very good news, we have the convergence of the algorithm without assuming that gamma L tends to zero as L goes to infinity. So now we can expect good numerical properties of the method. So we have this new operator. One question which arises is, how can we compute this? Is it easy? Do we have some tools? So the first property is that this prox is also defined as follows. It's simply the solution of a minimization problem of the minimization of function f plus a quadratic distance to the current point x. So we can see that now we have a good tool to compute the proximity operator for a given function f. So for instance, a very well-known property is that when f is our indicator function of a convex set, now we have that the proximity operator is exactly equivalent to the well-known projection on a convex set. We also have many other functions for which this proximity operator has an explicit form. For example, we have a large family of log-concave probability densities, for example, Laplace, uniform, or Gaussian. and also many other functions. So I give here this reference of the book chapter from Combeck and Pesquet, where you can find many functions and their proximity operators, and also many useful properties of this operator. So now, thanks to this new algorithm, we are able to deal with non-differentiable function. So the next step is what happens is if we want to minimize a function, which is the sum of a differentiable plus a non-differentiable term. So we would like to minimize f plus g. So of course, we can say, okay, f plus j is non-differentiable. So let's use the previous algorithm. But we would like to take advantage of the differentiability of G to improve the numerical properties of the algorithm. And so we derive the forward-backward algorithm, which is defined as follows. So it alternates between two steps. The first step is a gradient step on the smooth function G, and an explicit step, so this is the proximity operator, of the non-smooth function f. So this algorithm is also known for certain case of function f as the iterative soft thresholding algorithm. So it is when f is the L1 norm. So we can also derive a relaxed form of this algorithm, and the convergence of this method has been proved under boundedness assumption on the step size gamma n lambda l in the convex case, and also very recently in the non-convex case, so when f and g are non-convex, assuming that f and g satisfy this Kurdyka-Wojasiewicz assumption. So I will not give the expression of this assumption, but you must know that this assumption will be satisfied for a large class of functions such as semi-algebraic function, analytic function, basically all the functions you could meet in the context of inverse problems. And you must know also that this assumption will be at the heart of many recent work in non-convex optimization. We have this forward-backward algorithm. However, when we try it on a real problem, it appears that the convergence of this algorithm can be quite slow, simply because this is a first-order method, which only uses some information on the gradient, on the criterion. And so the aim of this talk is to present two acceleration strategies for this forward-backward algorithm. So the first strategy I will present is based on the principle of majoration minimization. So let me first give the majorized minimized assumption. So now we will focus on the smooth term J, and we would like to accelerate this gradient step on J. So we will make an assumption is that we can build a quadratic approximation of J around the current point XL. So this quadratic approximation will read as follows. So it looks like a second order Taylor approximation. But now we have here a matrix AL which will parameterize this approximation. And moreover, we make the assumption that this quadratic function is a majorant function. What does it mean? It means that Q must be greater than J on all its domain. And of course, by construction, we can see that J equals to Q at the current point XL. So the first question is, can we find such a matrix AL for a generic function J? The answer is yes. If we take any differentiable function J, assuming that it has a Lipschitz gradient, we can simply choose AL equals to beta, so the Lipschitz constant, times an identity matrix. So we can always find a simple choice for AL. So now we can define what is called the MM algorithm, so majorized minimized algorithm. So it is defined as follows. We are at the current iterate XL. We built our quadratic approximation, Q. And we define XL plus 1 as the minimizer of F plus the quadratic Q. So graphically, this is what we obtain. We are at the current point XL. We have the in orange the quadratic bajorant, and XL plus 1 is defined as its minimizer, and the same for XL plus 2, etc. So we can see that by construction, this LMM algorithm will ensure the decrease of the objective function along iteration. So we have already, by construction, a monotonicity property, which is interesting from a convergence point of view. And another very interesting property is that this algorithm is exactly equivalent to the forward-backward algorithm if we choose AL equals to beta identity, so the simple choice I mentioned earlier. So since we would like to accelerate the forward-backward algorithm, the idea is not to do this simple choice, but to choose more sophisticated matrices. And we could hope that if this Majorant function in orange is a very tight approximation of the green function, we will have a fast convergence. And using this remark, we obtain the variable metric forward-backward algorithm. So before introducing this algorithm, I need to define a new mathematical tool, which is called the proximity operator relative to a metric. So it is defined as follows. So we recover the definition of the prox, but here I just change this quadratic distance by adding the matrix A as a weight in the norm. And now we can define the variable metric for a backward algorithm. So it's defined as follows. So we recover the gradient step on J, but now we have in front of the gradient the inverse of AL. And this matrix will play the role of a preconditioner. And so it will have the effect of accelerating the convergence. And here we need to compute the proximity operator in the metric induced by AL. So, of course, this algorithm is just another notation. It's completely equivalent to the MM algorithm I mentioned in the previous slide. It's just another way of presenting things. So the convergence of this algorithm has been proved quite recently in the convex case by Combet et Vu. And in the non-convex case, we prove the convergence of the iterates for assuming that AL satisfies this majorizing assumption. And the most important is that introducing this matrix AL, which really leads to an acceleration of the convergence. So the idea is to choose AL to have a good quadratic approximation of G. So this is the first point. And the second point is that we do not want to increase the computational cost per iteration. So of course, we will choose AL so that this is not costful. So usually in practice, we choose diagonal matrices, AL, but other choices can also be made. So I present in the application part an illustration of this acceleration. So now I have presented a way to accelerate the convergence in the sense that we will need less iteration to reach the minimizer of the function. And now I will focus on the reduction of the computational cost per iteration, because we are dealing with very large problems. So the idea, so we made the following assumption. F is block separable. Maybe I will go fast. So we assume that function F only acts on small blocks on the vector. And the idea is at each iterate, we will only update a small part of this large vector X. So of course, we can see that the computational cost will be much reduced because we deal with much smaller problems at each iteration. So we have the convergence of these methods, and we also shown that it can be combined with the variable metric strategy. So it will benefit from the advantage of the two methods. So now we'll speak to skip to the application part. So the first application is a parallel MRI. So the challenge in the idea of parallel MRI is to use parallel acquisition strategy to reduce the exposition of the patient to large magnetic field. So we have parallel acquisition using several coils and also a compressive sensing strategy. Another difficulty is that we need to estimate complex valued signals. So we need to adapt the optimization algorithms. So these are the results. So this is the original image and what we obtain using a regularization based on wavelets. And we can see that the resolution is very good on this example. So here we use 32 parallel coils and a compressive sensing ratio of 5. And on this example, we were able to compare several proximal algorithms. We can see that they are all competitive. And we have quite fast convergence in around 2 minutes on a laptop, on a MATLAB. Another example is the problem of phase retrieval. Phase retrieval, it's a very difficult problem because we only measure the modulus of linear the transformation of the object. So we completely lose the phase information and we need to recover the phase. We consider the case when the measurements are not in Fourier. For example, in our case, they are in the Radon domain. This modulus will lead to a complicated non-convex data fidelity term. So this is what we propose. So this is a result of a state-of-the-art method based on alternating projection. And this is what we obtain. So here we use the block alternating strategy because the problem is such a large size that we are not able to handle the full size of the data at each iteration. So this is the real part and the imaginary part of the restored image. And on this example, we compare two variants of the algorithm with the variable metric and without the variable metric. So we can see that adding this matrix AL really improves the convergence speed of the algorithm. Now I will present some preliminary results on blind deconvolution of video. The problem is blind, which means that we need to restore both the image and also the blur operator. So we don't know how the image has been degraded. So this is a complicated problem because it is blind, and it will lead to also a complicated non-convex data fidelity term. And here we use an alternation strategy, where we estimate either the image or the blur. So this is the result. So these are an extract of a true video provided by INA. And this is on the right, the restored image using total variation regularization. And if we zoom, we could see that thanks to our regularization strategy, we really reduced the noise and also some oscillation in the images. And this is what we estimate for the blur kernel. And finally, I finish with an example of application of my colleague Giovanni Cercia. We deal with multi-channel image restoration. So multi-channel, so it's sometimes called multi-spectral. So such data can be obtained sometimes in satellite imaging when a scene is acquired at different spectral bands. So we do not have only one image, but a cube that we need to restore. So here the challenge was to provide a regularization which is able to deal with this multi-channel form of the data. And also here they deal with a constrained formulation of the problem in order to avoid this setting of regularization parameter. And the optimization problem was then solved using epigraphical techniques. So these are the results. So I only show one channel of the image. So the original, the observed image here, it is in the context of in painting, I can say. We only observe 10% of the pixel of the image plus some noise. This is a result of a state-of-the-art method called hyperspectral TV. And this is what we obtain, so we can see the real benefits on using this specific regularization approach. So they also compare to so several optimization strategies, and we could say that we could see that these epigraphical techniques lead to very fast optimization algorithms. So finally, in this talk, I show that the proximity operator is a very efficient tool to solve large scale and possibly difficult optimization problem. I provide two recipes to accelerate this algorithm. So the MM strategy, which will really act on the convergence speed, and the block alternation, which will reduce the computation cost and the memory requirement per iteration. I do not talk about it, but you must know that there exist primal dual algorithms which are able to deal with not only the sum of two functions, but the sum of more than two functions, eventually combined with complicated linear operators. And some parallel implementation of this algorithm are possible using splitting techniques. So future challenges are finding more tricks to accelerate the algorithm. Thank you for your attention.
So thank you, Emily. We have time for a few questions.
I have a question about so you're mentioning the possibility to use a variable metric. Mm-hmm. This sounds like an appealing thing to be able to do, but at the same time, the in a certain number of cases, the proximal operator will probably be harder to compute. So can you comment on the situation where, I'm sure there's a situation where this is useful. Can you comment on which situation this would be?
Okay, so maybe I will go back to the definition of this new proximity operator. So in practice, you must be careful on how you choose this matrix AL, and this is also the reason why we choose it diagonal, so that finally, when AL is diagonal, the cost of the proximity operator is almost the same than the usual proximity operator. There also exist some properties in the case when AL can be splitted under specific form, for example, rank-one matrices. But of course, this is an important point, and there is a compromise between the increase in computation cost and the acceleration of the convergence.
Next question.
I had two small questions. The first one about the hyperspectral imagery, you were talking about 10% pixels. How many channels did you have?
Here, it's around 200 channels.
200 channels. And the 10% were the exact same pixels on each of the bands, or do you take a specific amount per channel, the different ones?
So I'm not the author of this work, but I think that these are not the same 10% pixel for each channel. This is why we are succeeding to recover a good quality of the image.
All right. And there was also a kernel that you recovered from the blind deconvolution. Mm-hmm. How come this kernel is negative?
Yeah, it's true. In fact, this K kernel comes from the data comes from video archive, and in fact it's come from an analogical oscillation effect. So I think this is why we observe some negative values, because it's some kind of continuous time kernel.
Any other question? Okay, let's thank the speaker again.